Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for being here to switch on the light with us. This project is called Light On. That is to say, we need to put light on something. In this case, we have to put light, to make light for people, and to introduce you an office, an important office, Snøhetta, and listen to what Mr. Thorsen will say about his job. I think everybody knows his international studio. This is the first of a series of meetings that iGuzzini is promoting. Our company has been always interested into promoting architecture and lighting. So we created a partnership with the MAXXI Museum in Rome that will be held for the next 5 years. Anyway, our partnership has started more than 10 years ago. So in the next 3 years, we will have a series of meetings here in Recanati and also in Rome, together with great designers from around the world, of course, Italian ones, everyone knows here in Italy, but also architects coming from many countries in the world, bringing their culture and their activities here. As you know, this is exactly included in our strategy of cultural development of our company, of the territory, and the wish to develop knowledge competition, of course, pushed a lot. Competition was really pushed, was pushing towards LEDs, so everybody is trying to interpret this economy and put it into action, implement it in a single project and in implementing it in order to be ready to always offer the best answer with the best technologies which need to be made up of services and products which are in line with the sustainable growth, and by illuminating indoor and outdoor spaces, we want to offer a social service, so to speak, and helping out people, because as you know, people and light in spaces makes life better for men, for human beings, in terms of well-being. We start from there, and as you may know, we also had some experiences with biodynamic light in 1985, which was the first one in the world with some patents with the CNR in Italy and the Light Design Center in Detroit, in order to develop, to go on studying the way human beings perceive light and are influenced by it. So innovation through lighting is something which is in our blood, something which we want to do in order to involve societies all over the world in order to offer the best products and services. This is what we want to do to operate at international level. This is our strategy. I know it's ambitious, and thank God up to today we had great success and overall growth in terms of service and quality. So we think this is the right way to follow. As you know, we are having a lot of activities And we have always worked hand in hand with people living in our territory at regional and national and at international level, because working hand in hand with industrial people here in Recanati and together with the Italian universities here in the region. So when I talk about international countries, I always think of China or the US or wherever the world, because in each country there is something to be understood and something to be exchanged with in terms of culture and the interpretation each architect gives to light when they conceive projects. So how they think, what they think light is and what is its importance. So we need to understand that in order to offer the best service and products once again. So it is a mix of knowledges that makes the society richer. We want to be a company which is social, which is cultural, a company which puts these services at the service of societies and human beings. I would like to conclude my presentation about these basic principles which are at the basis of my company. This is the first meeting of the five which will be held this year. I would like Pippo Ciora to come here. He works in the MAXXI in Rome. We've collaborated with him a lot. And so Pippo, please come to the floor. Thank you.
Cose molto brevemente. La prima è una parrucca castagna, mi passo un po' e mi porto i saluti della mia direttrice, Margherita Cuccione. Who is speaking Italian? So you have to check
this.
E che non è potuta essere qui, ma che sarà domani ad accogliere Kjetil a Roma.
Prova.
Okay, thank you. So we are very glad to launch this project together with iGuzzini and our region. I work in Rome, but I come from the Marche region. Our project is called Light and Architecture. This is a dream that we developed with Giovanni and iGuzzini in the last years, and thanks to the iGuzzini family, we were able to implement it, and that is to say to develop this lecture series, which is of a high quality, bringing here loads of people here in the Marche region who are willing to listen to these architectural lectures, both in Recanati and in Rome. The project is called Lights On. Every year we'll be held 5 to 6 lectures and meetings. We are trying to have some broken hood and many architects to these meetings, which are really interested in light. We'll have meetings in March, July, and in the future months. This is a project which highlights an idea which is very important here in the Marche region, and it is synergy. The criterion we are following when inviting architects is the following. We want architects offering us a look towards the future. We are have some of other friends, architect friends, like Zaha and others, but we are also looking for new architects which are well in the 21st century, because they have a social role different from the last century. Snøhetta is an example of that. This is a perfect example. example of this. So we are happy to start with them. When I was young and I was writing my first book, I was forced to go and bring my text to Manfredo da Furi. So this was a terrible experience for me. So I went to him. At first he said, why do I have to read that? After that, he said that in your life, the only thing you can do, and whatever you do, try to build a mountain of things, of knowledge, products, and ideas that people need to take into account of what you do. Snøhetta, inspired from a mountain. So I think this is a great idea. It is a mountain saying a lot of things. It has a complex shape. It is in the middle of Norway. So it's a natural environment, which is somehow scary, because sometimes nature is scary. So we are happy to start with an office like this. They started working together during the Alexandria in Egypt. They were very young. They were working in different offices in California and in Oslo. And they used to live over a brewery, beer brewery. And so they were able to win this international business. And from there, a career started, which is very interesting. On one side, they built unforgettable works of art, like the Ground Zero Museum I was visiting a few days ago, like a series of libraries, for instance, which are very interesting and important. But also, this studio grew up with people which have a different attitude. We always know that when you work in an office, you of a very important architect, it's difficult to see that architect inside his own or her own office. Whereas here it's different. The physical organization of the two offices in New York, Oslo, and the brand new in New York, which is about to open up. So it is, they have a great cooperation inside. So we are very interested into their job, which is very contemporary, which doesn't repeat other designs. They face challenges and fix them and meet them. Their way of working is an integral part of our job. Another interesting thing is this Egypt library at the end of the 1980s. Protected by human beings during the Arab Spring, so that it wouldn't be devastated by riots. And now they also work in very small projects like the new Norway kinds. So they go from the largest project to the smallest ones. They can build great cultural buildings with a processual process attitude. You can have an office where you are not closed in a single city, but they refer to the way of doing of many places. They worked in Oslo, they opened up in New York, they are working on the Mario Botta FS Moms, opening up a new studio in San Francisco. So everybody is working in clouds, like in everybody, maybe one, maybe working in Paris, one may be working in Amsterdam or wherever. So the Snøhetta example is very important. I'll stop my presentation now. I think, well, I am very glad to see so many of you, to see my students here, to see a lot of students coming from the Marche region students. So I would like to thank iGuzzini for hosting us, also for organizing this in this wonderful space. Thank you.
I apologize for all the wrong things I said.
Kjetil, ti ringrazio. There is something which I hate in young people. When they, it's their turn to make questions, they just go dumb. Well, this person, Mr. Thorsen, is available to make any questions, so please feel free to do so.
I think that everybody should be speaking English, but if you wish, there is a simultaneous interpretation service in channel 12. So thank you, Pier Giovanni, for the whole organization. Please, Kjetil, come to the floor. Snøhetta office is made up of great directors and Mr. Thorsen and so many great people working up together.
Thank you so much for coming. It's almost like I heard the city has between 20 and 30,000 inhabitants. Almost half of them here. It's incredible. I understand it's a rainy afternoon. That makes a difference, probably. At the same time, I'd like to thank iGuzzini for the invitation. Thank you so much. It's really... we have some music, yes? Okay. Yes. Well, thank you so much for the invitation. It really is a great honor to be here. We had a fantastic tour of the factory today. I was very impressed. I have to tell you, I'm not so easy to impress. So I thought it was really a very, very nice tour. So thank you very much for organizing this. My partner Craig has been in Rome at the American Academy for some time now. And all of a sudden, it seems like we have this close contact to Italy, which we haven't had for many years, except for being in contact with Carrara and Forte del Marmi, where we take our stones from all the time, and where we have our collaborating artists working. I was wondering a little bit how to spend the time with you this afternoon. There are many ways we could approach this particular issue of dealing with architecture. Per se, I could have gone into one or two projects in detail, since there are many students. Again, I've chosen more to go in a direction where I believe that we, as a company, might be able to prepare ourselves for a very uncertain architectural future. Now, I know this sounds a little pessimistic at the opening of a lecture, but let me say, the profession is changing dramatically. And it will change continuously in the next 5 to 10 years. Turnkey projects, who's actually making decisions based on what, who's in power, what are the political situations for architecture in the future. We are struggling in a world with less money. We have crisis after crisis. We have urbanization issues. We have environmental issues, which are so penetrating for the moment that unless we do change the profession to some extent, will probably not survive as a profession. I'm not going to be more negative than that. That's the most negative I'm going to say today, because the rest is kind of positive. So what I'm going to try to do is to show you a little bit of how we think that we in our office and in our collaborative partnership need to evolve, and what types of things we need to be engaged in, and how we define these type of things in the possible future. It starts very easily by saying, okay, we're named after a mountain. So it starts from the very beginning, but it's, like we heard, not really the mountain we're named after. We're named after a beer place downtown Oslo, which has the same name as the mountain area where Snøhetta is the highest peak. And we were sort of sitting on top of this Dovre Hall, and this area is called Dovre, and the highest peak is Snøhetta. We had the connection down the back stair, past the toilets and into this beer place where we could sit and, like every young architect at the time, sketch on napkins, talk about how to change the world, and drink port wine and beer. But it evolved, and we've finally come to some sort of ways of looking at conclusions of what is it actually we're doing. We've been very uncertain for many, many years. There's been a lack of definition, maybe, almost, to what ideology, what type of philosophy is it actually we're working after. It's been like almost intuitive reactions on certain things that were challenges in front of us, and we've jumped them and we've solved them the best way we could. But after involving ourselves more thoroughly with what and analyzing what we've been doing, we've been coming closer and closer to ourselves. It's a little like Alvar Aalto saying, the thing with the wave I discovered afterwards. It's kind of a process that you know is already there, but you don't know exactly why it is there. One of the things we've started looking at is, what is creativity? And how does creativity evolve in a process? We have landed, for the moment, on a certain aspect of creativity being distinctive. Distinctive in the sense that it's more than only contextual, but it's distinctive in itself. Which means, yes, it does solve a local or conditional problem, but that alone is not enough unless it is distinctive in itself. That can be compared to, say, the reindeer, which we see here by Snøhetta in Norway, which is a genetic line of reindeer families coming from the south of France, which everyone was feeding at 15,000 years ago in order to survive. And when the ice pulled back, these reindeer followed. That's the distinctiveness we're talking about. In the further development of that, we think there is a distinctive simplification. Now, simplification does not mean taking away the underlying complexity of this distinctive situation. It means to try to catch the core and maintaining the complexities that you have in architecture. Not getting rid of them, but defining them inside a certain type of simplification. From the very beginning, we've had four main professions in the office. It's been landscape architecture, architecture and urbanism. It's been interior architecture and art. And the Snøhetta group was formed on the collaboration between these professions. 4 years ago, we also included graphic design. And last year, we were asked to do the annual report for another lighting company called Sumtober, where we invited and interviewed four people over 100 years old north of the polar circle about their perception of light. Now remember, these people were born before electricity was introduced, and simply by the fact of being old, they were experts. They were experts on certain parts of history that very few are still experts on, simply because they were old. This is a type of expertise which society is, of course, using not to the extent it could be using it. We had then fashion photographers taking pictures of them. We were scanning their heads so we can actually print physical sculptures of them, and we're exhibiting them and we're turning them into heroes. We also won the competition to design the new Norwegian money. As you know, we're not part of the euro. But thanks God, we're also not part of the Swiss franc. But apart from that, this kind of design issue that we're now evolving is that we are really wanting to get into everything that is more or less tangible in the society that we're living within. And the next step, obviously, is industrial design and how that will interact with architecture, with urban design, with graphic design, with art in its full explosive manner. Now, how do we deal with that on a project basis? You can look at the conditions and the parameters that we're setting as this cylinder that you see here, and you can see these balls being people, right? So you have extraordinary flexibility within the framework of the company, individual flexibility. And then it comes together, and at that particular point, you release energy. What you see, however, is that that one person who went straight for the goal, he is missing. He goes in a straight line towards the goal, and he will miss. Why is that? Because the goals are continuously moving. So there is no way that we will allow creative work in the group to go straight for the goal. That's why it takes so long before we start designing or actually drawing. That's why it takes so long for us to actually go in and describe to each other what we're doing before we're doing it. We call that a singular in the plural model. And the singular in the plural means that the basic for a collaborative is based on the quality and the input of each individual. We don't turn it the other way around and start by defining the collaborative and then inject individuals. No, it goes the other way around. That means that we have organizational diagrams that start off like this. This is a desk where there is a person behind. Each desk is representing a different profession. We don't put people together in project groups. Scratching? Is it okay? Scratching? And each of those sitting behind the desk is collaborating with the other in a very informal way. So if you had a very formal setup, that would be then formalized through a hub situation of one person. But if you go informal, it will lead you in the end to this type of organizational diagram. Let's say one project has developed something that is thrown away, which cannot be used. That particular item might really be very useful for another project. That's why we're not putting projects in groups in the room. Another method we have developed is transpositioning. Transpositioning means that we regard ourselves as studio musicians rather than the pop stars. Because studio musicians go in and play any instrument in the end. They know all types of music. They understand the depth and the understanding of this particular element that they go in and do. Now, this transpositioning method then also means that we invite others to go in and take different positions. The architect becomes the engineer. The engineer becomes the doctor. The doctor becomes the sociologist. The sociologist becomes the musician. The musician becomes the landscape architect. And in creative work, you've left your pre-assumption of that particular profession behind and moved in and taken somebody else's profession. That means you don't have to take responsibility for what you say on behalf of your own profession in that meeting, which again means that you can push the boundaries of the possibilities you have. Of course, you get the lawyer for free in any case because he stays lawyer. And of course, he goes back to be a lawyer when we go to court. But in creative work, this mixing of different positions has shown itself to be very important. We are located with two bigger offices, one in New York and one in Oslo. As you can see, we're looking for similar locations always. It's to do with the water, it's to do with peninsulas, it's to do with the perception of where you are. Right now, we're opening an office in San Francisco. We already have an office in Innsbruck, one in Singapore. So we're expanding on a studio basis, but very small expansions, not huge. So how do we sort of define these starting points into actual architecture? Once you start translating these things, what happens then? In a book called Creative Works, we've had three doctorates and a research team working on what do we do as Snøhetta when we are at our best. And this was sort of a research on us. How do we work together? What kind of themes do we put forward? we call these themes generic drivers. And these drivers are not drivers that everyone has to follow like a book when you're designing, but it's a good way of moving back and making comparisons. Did we think about that, or was that something that appeared in that particular element? The first one is zooming. Now, zooming means zooming in and out. Let's say that the horizon of the library in Alexandria was existing before the building came in. So then you zoom out historically in time, and you go from past, present to future, simply by one section, which you could say is the movement of the sun from above the horizon till below the horizon. Simple diagram in time. That can physically translate directly into a section of a building. It isn't much more complicated. And once that translation is done, that generates the possibility of going into detail and zooming down into the artwork that the artists are doing, hand carving the stones and moving that part of history forwards. Or it could be moving all the way out again and looking at the skyline of Alexandria and making sure that that skyline, as you move out, is exactly the representation of the library as a more peaceful place compared to the verticality and horizontality of Alexandria in itself. Or it could be zooming all the way down to the design of a chair or the screw of a chair. And as you zoom in and out continuously, you have two funneling principles, one conceptual, one materialistic. And once these start scrutinizing each other somewhere in the middle, there is a solution happening. It could also be our Hong Kong project for the M+. It's all about zooming and framing certain aspects of life. Now, the certain slowness that comes into zooming particular elements of a building in a repetitive manner, of course, themselves start looking at how do I define that particular space I'm in, how do I look at it when I'm inside of it, and how does it look when I look from outside in. From inside out, it can be simple, just framing certain outdoor or indoor situations that actually makes the space you're in darker in order for the space outside to look even lighter. It's a way of creating contrasts in that particular perception. Similarly, we've created a whole series of ready-mades. These are just concrete boxes that you can buy in any concrete shop, basically. And what we use them to just frame certain aspects of nature in order to emphasize certain layers of experience, okay? You have the concrete box, you have the field, you have the forest, you have the ocean with the horizon, and you have the sky. Now, how much easier can you paint a picture just by framing it with one simple element? We expanded on this in the setting of looking at the framing of a museum. So this became a museum with the natural light coming from above and with only one photograph inside. Yes, it's what we call a keyless structure. It's open 24 hours a day. No surveillance in these spaces. It can also be zooming in and out in scale. Now, if you remember Angkor Wat and the water surrounding Angkor Wat is a implementation of how to maintain the earth of Angkor Wat, but when it's loaded by heavy building from spreading towards the outside. So the weight of the water is heavier than the weight of the earth, and by that you create a canal around Angkor Wat which holds it into place. In this particular case, it's an atomic accelerator in Malmö that starts, when you start accelerating, it starts vibrating. And we create a landscape surrounding it that counteracts the vibration of that particular building in order to keep it stable. So all of a sudden, the landscape plan is an interactive part of the solution of the building. It can go all the way down to the smallest elements that we've done, the beehives in Oslo. 80,000 inhabitants, 80,000 bees. We made two of them. They produced about 80 kilos of honey this summer. So you can see, zooming is an important element. We have generative resistance. Generative resistance to us is important because it's to do with the forces that you actually fight on an everyday basis. And these forces are important. They are generating you to take on new positions because their way of being resistant against what you're doing is so heavy. Okay, let's take, for instance, the environment. Here we have two diagrams, one showing that the embodied energy in different materials that we're producing today is part of the main consumption of energy in a building. So that means that in an industrial terms, it's not only the way that we perceive the consumption of energy in a building that matters when it comes to energy, but it is actually the construction of them. It's more than 40%. Now look at, for instance, how much embodied energy is in the photovoltaic production of solar cells. You can imagine that you have to spend good time and good location on photovoltaic cells. Wonderful, thank you. Of the location of the photovoltaic cells for them to make sense when it comes to energy production. And again, I've said this before, one of the forces against is there is enough energy in the world. It's just the wrong type of energy. We have to change from one type of production of energy to another, to clean production of energy. So the only fight that we have today in the building industry when it comes to environmental aspects is, of course, CO2 negative buildings. We've been trying this in this particular building here in Trondheim, which is the northernmost portion where you can actually create CO2 negative buildings, calculated over a period of 60 years. We've finally received the go, and it will finish within the next 3 years. It's been a long fight because it didn't suit the looks. It didn't look like the architecture that was there from before. It didn't have the implementation within the regulation plan. And it claimed that it was an alien, or the public, the politician claimed it was an alien in that setting. We said, form follows environment. So, here in Paris, we made another approach. We were asked by a big company to design this huge 1 million square meter shopping mall, hotels, leisure centers, indoor skiing, massive, 1 million square meters. And they said, and you have to locate it on this agricultural land here in the corner of Gonesse, just outside of Paris. We said, no, you cannot build a building of this size on agricultural land, unless you take the 30 centimeters with so much embodied energy and generations of work, put it carefully aside, put it all back with 1 meter of drainage and 30 centimeter of production line back on top of the roof of this building. You increase food production by doing it because you have the heat. You get 2 times potatoes. And of course, which we didn't know when we started, was that 500,000 square meters is the average size of a French farm. So here's a French farm. And these are the farmlands on top of a 1 million square meter shopping mall. You cannot only react top down, you also have to react bottom up. This is from Guatemala City, where we were asked to do any type of project we would choose because the mayor thought we would go in and do an iconic building which would help him politically. No, we chose to secure the sidewalks so that the women selling their oranges will not be disturbed by cars parking on the sidewalks continuously. So we created what we call pigs, benches that are too heavy to move for the cars, and they squat the sidewalks, and we worked with local artists, and now we have about 300 benches. But it could also be time like this work with Ola for a liaison, which is this slow interpretation of how things can evolve in the future. That might also be something that is a strong resistance. Time and slowness. Another one, very important for me, is liberating laughter. Everyone thinks that what we're doing is so serious that it cannot be joked about. Well, it's true. At the same time, it's so serious it cannot be joked about. So if you put that into context and you look at how is your working relationship in order to release certain situations, we have to make sure that we produce elements that are fun. Little movie for electrical car called Think, and we actually did and created the bubbles, and it's so much fun to drive an electrical car inside a bubble like this. It was shown at the Geneva car fair some years ago. It's amazing that maybe in the end the only place where you can find clean air is inside the bubble where you drive an electrical car. I mean, if you did the same with a diesel, you know where you would be. I think putting these things together is what makes life easy. It doesn't matter what size. We've continuously been trying to encourage curiosity and curiousness by employees. Let me put one example. When we started working on the memorial project at Ground Zero in New York, we were interested in trying to find out how you can portray two types of realities at the same time. What do? You use a prism where you put a picture of this car twice through one element in one timeline. At the same time, you portray the car two times. So this doubling up is kind of two types of reality. We try to continue evolving that prism system for it to take daylight in and take the colors of the different types of daylight by orienting the prism and either down towards the asphalt, where you had the dark colors, towards the green, towards the sky, and all of a sudden you would have a mix of colors being portrayed into the element of architecture. So, Pei White created a stage curtain. You might think that that is something that is three-dimensional. Of course, it's not. It is woven, it's flat. It doesn't have one silver thread. The curiousness is the other way of dealing with the process. Once you go there, you go from flatness to three-dimensional and from three-dimensional to flatness. Like we also did with the two balloon. Looking at this little pavilion for jazz music outside of Oslo and knowing exactly where the beer tent would be downtown and where you would want to listen to the music on stage. So here is the public, which is close to the event on this stage. And this throws the music down exactly to the beer tents downtown Kongsberg. So what is rapid prototyping in the essence of moving forward? It is taking the files that you have. Remember, people, we might not own anything but our computer files in the future. That might really be the only thing that we could put copyright to and hold to ourselves. But also remember that Elon Musk published all his patents for his electrical car online last year. Now, what does he do when he does that? He says two things. He says, one, I'm better than the others, because you can have what I've already spent or used. And he says, I really believe in the further development of the electrical car. Two things. So what we've done in rapid prototyping is try to take design that is directly translated on through the computer files into a production line. We tested it the first time with what is this reindeer pavilion up at Snøhetta. So let's say you choose analog the wood. You test the files in our own computer, which we have here, a computer production line, which is a robot, a cooker machine. So we know the files are correct. They don't have a hiccup. And we go straight. And that gives a result, all of a sudden, which is in a different context. No drawings really anymore. No drawings on site, just a production line. And that gives, of course, a more dynamic relationship between what you see from the landscape side, landscape point of view. But it also means we could repeat the building as many times as we want, but they would never be the same because the choice of wood would still be analog. We worked with the artist Bjarne Melgo. He's very eccentric. He's Norwegian, he lives in New York. And he came to us and said, okay, I want you to design my house, but I want to draw the house. But I want you to design it, I want to draw it. So this is what his drawing of a house looks like, the one he wants to live in. And we said, okay, I like the penis handle. That's when the brush sort of turns from inside out. That actually means that we can shape them in three dimensions, not like Latin letters, which are just, if you make them three-dimensional, they will just be extrusions of themselves. No, there are elements. And calligraphy, Arabic calligraphy, is so beautiful. And once you get to the end of it, you can put it all together, and then, of course, it's an ornament. Knowledge-based intuition is another one. So, Italo Calvino has written a book called Invisible Cities. That's based on a conversation between Kublai Khan and Marco Polo. In the description, one of the cities, they're talking about the Roman arch. Kublai Khan says, the keystone of the Roman arch is the culture of our society. If you remove the keystone, the bridge will collapse. If you remove culture, society will collapse. My further interpretation is the foundations of this bridge is the economy of society. If you still maintain the pressure from one stone to the other through this arch, it will not collapse. But if you take away the pressure between them, it will collapse. Now, of course, we have ethical dilemmas, all of us, when we work in places where we think that the politics of the place are not the right. We have chosen to follow a Norwegian line, which is called dialogue. We go in to most places and try to change things with how we see it. So we took this and created a project for Saudi Arabia with a keystone. Remember that in Saudi Arabia today, there are no theaters, there are no cinemas, there are no some few museums, basically no libraries. And by creating a cultural building that in itself has a keystone, and if you remove that, the whole complex will collapse. Now, to argue this in a pluralistic, strong society like Saudi Arabia can be difficult, but it points at two things. It says, yes, it is possible if we discuss it correctly. There is a cultural interest, and we might come to a point where we can introduce this in reality, meaning the first public cinema will be in this building, there will be a theater, there will be a library, there will be a concert house. And these type of functions then realize themselves through typical elements of complexity. In this particular case, it is how the geometry of each element, of each pebble, is designed, and how it's bent. So this whole building is clad with pipes, stainless steel pipes of 90 millimeter strength, again bent through this type of computer-controlled production line. So there is extreme precision in the steelworks. And that means, oops, that means that we're getting a building which starts in geometry by wrapping these pipes continuously geometrically around this building. Now, these are the first construction photos. And you will see here that each pipe now also has the capacity of taking the heat up to plus 80 degrees centigrade out of the air and transforming that into energy and hot water inside the building. So in a way, you can see by pushing cultural elements into societies where you think you shouldn't be doing things, in this case, has been taken so beautifully open and generous from Saudi. And we strongly believe that with Saudi Aramco as a client here, we're moving a big step ahead in trying to educate their young people in the direction of good cultures. The other material we used is rammed earth. From the site, packing the whole of the interior with rammed earth as a contrast to the stainless steel. So this building is on its way. Other way we've dealt with this is by moving a piece of Norway to Berlin for the Norwegian embassy. This is a 150-ton large stone, which was transported from Oslo to Berlin and put in front of the ambassador's office so he couldn't get a window here. It is the biggest stone transported out of Norway, and it is cheaper than a glass facade of any type. The same we did with this small project up in the northern parts of Norway, where they asked us to draw and design a visitor center to this little chapel. And then they said, okay, we have this field here, you locate it here. No, you cannot. We have to create a new site for this building by cutting through a mountain existing with diamond wire. What is happening then is we're saying exactly what architecture is about. Architecture is constructed, friends. You don't need to build where you can do something else because it has a tectonic basic element in it. And then you just need to fill out the new site with a new building. That brings me back to the reindeer, because when we won the competition for the Lascaux caves in South France, we discovered that on these caves in southern France, exactly the same genetic reindeer were painted on these walls of Lascaux 15 to 18,000 years ago. So of course, that becomes a situation where you have to deal with it very carefully. Just open it up, look in, and all of a sudden, you're out of it again. We are recreating the caves with 0.3 millimeter precision. 50 painters are painting again the walls of Lascaux as a copy. Now, what type of Disneyland is that? Well, the Lascaux caves are completely closed for any type of scientists or any other visitors for the moment. So this is now the new original. And the new original will be better than nothing. Be generous. I'm getting close to all these kind of things to follow. Be generous is important. At the library in Alexandria, it was all about fighting for the position of the building, taking the plaza, the public plaza, and not protecting it with fences, giving it back to the public and fighting that fight for years. That then gave us something fantastic back, that the public in Alexandria protected the building during the riots in the spring, 24 hours a day. And that meant that the library never had to close. Now, if you can imagine a position for an architect to be in, that the public starts defending what you've done simply because they need this base for knowledge, then all of a sudden, you're in a new position. We've had similar reflections on the Opera House, where the public is gathered, where they're opening it up, and where you have a new generation of opera visitors simply because you open up, simply because you make it accessible individually, collectively, and you clean the situation. According to Norwegian law, you have to allow access to the water for everyone. You cannot fence in any portion of the water. There are other strange laws in Norway. One of them is that if anybody comes and knocks on your door and needs to go to the toilet, you have to let him in. Or, for instance, that you're allowed to put up your tent within 50-meter radius of any building and let it stand there for 3 days. And these particular laws are old, and they're also already almost like part of the attitude of how to deal with things, and so is this law of being allowed to get to the water. We're trying to implement the same things with the Times Square in New York, which is under construction. Again, just opening up new perceptions for people in a city by making it available. And you will see, once you introduce new type of elements into the flood and the river of people in a place like this, they will utilize these benches in a different manner. They will perceive the space differently, and they will use it differently. We try to do the same for the reconstruction of the Grand Palais in Paris, where we just took and mirrored the Grand Palais underground. Turned it upside down by creating a new public space in that mirror face between the two. Actually, it worked really well. It wasn't completely mirrored in the physical sense, but it was mirrored by glass and movement through the building, where you actually had all kinds of different elements relating to that movement for the public through the Grand Palais, and again being able to experience the big glass hall. Similarly, we've just won the Le Monde headquarters in Paris, and trying to evolve further on what media means and what Le Monde means by carving away from a solid, and by that creating a building that is the negative of the sphere instead of being the positive element of the sphere, and creating a media plaza, more area for the public than for the Le Monde itself. Hotspots, movement, and Batman is in the city. This happened the Monday after the Friday with Charlietto. It was a nightmare. And Le Monde, Pierre Bachet, said, "We still want a media house that is open and accessible and talks to the public. We don't want to become a fortress." Today you have to take a stand in architecture, how you make these things perceivable to the public. Architecture has a responsibility to take a stand in this direction. We do the same again in Saudi, which doesn't have any public spaces. This is a big station. Now we create a big public space in relationship to the subway station, hopefully at some point, and I hope nobody will hate me for this. If there is a big demonstration, now they have a space. We've been trying to do the same with one of the newest projects that we're just doing, which is the new opera house in Busan. Slowness is part of that.
Am I blind? You move your hand away from mine. I'm taking it as a sign that you're any less than mine. Oh, it doesn't move me to be cold. It doesn't lessen my hope. You know our time and all.
Trusting presence is another of these generic drivers. What does that mean? It means you believe in the place where you are at all points in time. To us, that means the office. It means the most important places that we have in the office. It means the meeting table, which at the same time is the dining table, which is exactly the same in New York and in Oslo. You have the coffee machine, the most important drug in the world, as we know. And you have the meeting space where we meet every Monday for what we call traffic, where you talk about everyone in the office, 110 people sitting in this space. We talk about divorces, we talk about new employees, we talk about babies, we talk about work, we talk about birthdays. And it becomes this place where things can be thrown up and where you can directly go through things that are of personal concern. And the workshop, of course, where things are happening continuously. So trusting your presence obviously also deals very strongly with the item of being able to design your presence. In this particular case, it is the MAXXI Center and how cancer post-treatment actually can be influenced by the design that you're actually doing. Charles Jenks and his wife had this idea, and they've been evolving on this issue for many years with a lot of good architects with extremely good results. Martial art. What is martial art? Martial art is taking the forces coming against you and turning that force back against your enemy. Now you can imagine, if you train martial art, you don't have to be strong. You just have to know how to divert the forces coming against you. Now, quite obviously, this becomes serious in certain situations. And once you're supposed to design things that are undesignable, really, and things that are uncreatable, together with large groups of people, then you have to trust that martial art perception. You can see all the big high-rise buildings here, you know. You have Pei, you have Frank Gehry. That is not happening, by the way. Norman Foster. You have the big station, Santiago Calatrava, who, by the way, has the station below us, so we have to have big transfer beams in order to get our forces down to the ground. But you can see, and that's a little Snøhetta project in the middle. You know the pools are called reflecting absence. We defined our project as reflecting presence. And that's what we've been trying to do in all ways of appearance. If you think back to the prisms that we started off with and how this has evolved into a reflecting surface that contains the entrance into the museum and the way we work with the different layers of complexity. We eat, love, and pray, or we can. It is important to meet, it's important to be close to the campfire, it's important to take care of the people you're involved with every day. And in order not to be all too political correct, you have to remember that if you don't break the law now and then, there is no fun. We'll be right back. Okay, thank you very much.
Allora, la conoscenza del contesto.
So knowing the context.
Dell'ambientazione.
Knowing the context.
Della società.
The setting and society. Certainly. One of the most important things before you design a project. This is an audience of architects.
Con difficoltà raggiungono.
Who will probably. Find it very, very difficult to work in places like the ones where you developed and implemented projects. It's really going to be difficult for us to work in such important contexts. So what kind of suggestions would you give to architects who will find it very difficult to be privileged to work in such settings and to have to deal with the daily problems in our profession?
Cannot deal with such freedom. Mm-hmm. We have a very complex made of constraints that are physical but social and economical. What's your advice?
Well, I was a professor in Innsbruck in Austria for about 4.5 years, 5 years. And we had a lot of discussions on these particular items. I have to tell you, it's not easy. As I said at the beginning, If you're looking at basically what you're interested in, then architecture is a way in to your own interest. Let's say you would be very interested in music. Then architecture might be a way into enhancing your understanding and interest in music. Don't look at architecture as a closed profession. Look at it as a way into things that you might fall into place with your personal ambitions. Sometimes that might be clean-cut architecture, but in other situations, it might be the most enhancing and beautiful public servant service. There is no negative or positive disturbance in relationship to how you seek happiness in your own life and in your own profession. The only thing I would advise, though, is that if you have habits, test the opposite of your habits for a while so you understand and know if they are real part of you or not. Say, if you only like to go to operas and never go to a football game, then go to a football game and drop the opera, or vice versa. If you sleep long in the morning, get up early for a time and see if that's part of your personality to sleep long. If it's not, you might get up early. You might change your life, changing from getting up late to changing to getting up early. Or if you get up early, maybe try to sleep long late. There's a whole series of things that you can do in order to create sort of your own position within your own understanding of the profession yet that you have chosen to pursue. But don't look at it limited. Because if you limit it, you're comparing too much with others, and I wouldn't compare. I don't know if it's an advice, but.
Mi chiamo Valentina.
So my name is Valentina.
E lei ha fatto vedere alcuni.
You showed some renderings and simulations in which you use natural light, daylight. And I would like to know if artificial light can give the same emotions, can donate the same emotions that you described in your project.
Wow. It's a very good question. We've had this afternoon a wonderful roundtable discussion on maybe some of these particular topics. I would still defend the position that there needs to be a certain difference between daylight and nighttime light, or summer light and winter light if you get further north. However, you can definitely create positions of atmospheric perception with both daylight and with let's call it artificial light in lack of a better word. But the exchange between these two is just as important. So we've had the discussion on what is it when a building inverts itself from day to night, for instance. So that means that the openings that let the daylight in during the day start becoming the expression, light expression of the building at night. So the building is inversing itself, and transparency is always related to the place where it is darkest and lightest. So if it's lightest on the inside and dark on the outside, you have transparency towards the inside. If it's lightest on the outside and darkest on the inside, you have transparency the other way. And reflection happens then. So yes, the perception of daylight and artificial light is artificial. Means you can create situations in both cases where you can ruin it or you can make it good. It's more a matter of doing it right than saying no or yes, if that was an answer. Yeah, we've had this. It's a big statement, but we've had this discussion. The cars have lamps, so why do you need street lighting? Just develop better car lamps. I mean, again, you know, you're moving on doubling up things, and it's a long discussion. But for instance, outdoor lighting in Norway then is being removed from highways. But at the same time, they're being increasingly used for cross-country skiing. So, you know.
Yeah.
Giulia Menzietti. My name is Giulia Menzietti. So I've been collaborating with the School of Architecture of Ascoli Piceno. I recently finished a PhD program. I was curious about the fact that almost all of Snøhetta projects are very different one from the other. It's very difficult to identify you with a special style or with a special language. And I think you, I assume you are aware of this. And my question is this a deliberate choice? Is there a willingness, in a way, of removing your signature, the signature of the architect from your project? Or does this happen simply by chance, because you are so sensitive to the individual contexts, to the needs of the project, and as a consequence, it is then normal and natural that every project is different from the other?
Also a good question, obviously. I tried to refer to this aspect of being a studio musician earlier. Yeah. So, which means, okay, we're not sort of, the Rihanna, but we're kind of the guys who can go into studio and play instruments for any type of musicians. So it doesn't mean that there isn't there is a very strong professional need in the office to portray ourselves within the things that we think are important. Aesthetics is important, and form is important, but it's not the only thing that is important. It is not it's not contradictory necessarily to social sustainability, environmental sustainability, cultural sustainability, but if there are other things that are more important than that particular form as a style, then we would never take on a style, and that would be conscious, because that would drive us into falsifying certain situations based on a different need, and we couldn't react in the same way, and that has been a conscious choice. But you see it with many others. I don't think we're the only ones doing that. Even I would say Herzog and Demeron do a lot of that. I would say there are many practices today on a global aspect that would want to get away from style.
But I think this is very important for our young architects now, because this is the specific character for me of our time. In the 20th century, architects were like political leaders or tailors. Now the political leaders are as much success as many people follow them and want to design in the same way. Or tailors, because you want to do always the same thing, because the lady has seen. Interesting now for the young architects, they don't have to copy anybody. They can develop a strategy, they can confront their process with the process of the people like Snøhetta that make it somehow but I think they don't need to be obsessed with this idea of defining their own style, no? Because it becomes sterile.
Yep.
And I think this is very much what art found out much earlier than architecture, no? Because in the end of the 20th century, artists started to spread their vocabulary into many different arts and many different way of being material or immaterial. Architecture, and we're talking here in the temple of an immaterial architecture, here architecture is starting to deal with the same contemporary condition. And I think that Snøhetta's work, even though it's very formally strong, but it doesn't rely on the obsession of form as a device to leave its trace on the ground.
At least that's what we're hoping, but...
Well, I'm the critic, yes, I can say.
Sono Luca Di Lorenzo.
So my name is Luca Di Lorenzo. I am a PhD student in Venice and assistant in the University of Ascoli Piceno. So I have a very simple question. Do you recognize, do you identify any master, so to say, in the history of architecture?
Affiliation.
Bruskov.
Ah, grande. Bruskov. Abbiamo chiesto un parere a Cristiano Trædal di Francia.
I would have lots of things to ask you because of all the definitions that you gave, which were really a very interesting. Lots of questions. For instance, these definitions, when they come before the project. You define some strategies, you know, because those were strategies, or they come like a sort of. Looking back, no, and synthesizing certain results that you achieved with the project that you built. So this goes back to the other thing. Is architecture just a problem-solving activity?
From the opposite side.
Or is a problem-finding activity? Because it looks like, I mean, with the last slide you showed us, And the artist that has this idea, fuck. I mean, this means that architecture gets out from its disciplinary boundaries, you know, and gets into the real world, which is made of continuous political fight in some way. So, where are you? You said everywhere you go, you start dialoguing, you know, dialoguing, trying to change. In some way, things. Then, your design is political. I mean, another observation, which is different, is the fact that one of the big debates is in the generic city. There are no more the piazzas. No, the Italian piazza, which were voids in the big volumes, in the massive constructed volume of the city, and it's. Those were the public spaces where people gathered. Now they don't exist anymore. Now they are all inside, of course, these anonymous spaces called shopping center. Looks like instead in your buildings, you create buildings which are like organic machines that attract people, you know? Mm. So they become like, instead of voids, they become volumes that attract people into this new kind of piazzas, which are like strange new mechanisms no? of a completely different type of city.
True.
I don't know.
Good answer on the problem. So well, we're going yeah. fine. And we like questions. That.
of course, fantastic observations. But on the problem solving, problem creating issue, I think I would put it slightly different. It's both or neither nor, in a way. If you go, and that would be a typical architect's answer in any case, if you were a client. But if you think of certain situations that are both conditional and contextual, this is what I meant by being conditional and contextual. It's not enough to be contextual. So if you have a conditional setup that you need to solve, let's say a city repair. Then that is part of the architectural task. But what you're doing is, at the same time, you're throwing up a criticism against what you have to repair. So there is no necessarily cutting off point. We've done protest projects on sites where something was designed and we just made protest projects because we wanted something else to happen. Not because we wanted ours to happen, but because we wanted something else to happen. The beehives, it is a problem-solving element, or part of a problem-solving element, because the bees are disappearing out of the cities.
Various sorts of problem-finding, yeah.
Cities of this world. But it's also trading problems, because then you have to distribute it, you have to have an organization, you have to have a political effect. Fortunately, in this particular case, with the beehives, it is actually served straight down to a food place in Oslo. So the transport line is very short. There are many examples of this contradiction, which maybe even sometimes leads to the perfect compromise. Ground zero is what we called negotiated architecture. It is a compromise. Efforts, okay, these are the beautiful cities that we love today, but they are not built on democracies. Is it possible to find an urban model that is a democratic urban model? We don't know. I haven't seen it. I don't think necessarily it exists, because that might be the death of democracy.
Or the death of architecture.
Or the death of architecture.
Or the death of architecture.
Yeah. So we are in this dilemma situation. And when we created the roof of the opera as a plaza, it was to give the plaza the positive volume in the city and not the negative volume. Well, so the edge of it goes down of the plaza. The edge of this plaza does not go up.
Salve a tutti, sono Mauro Forlini.
Hello, my name is Mauro Forlini. I am an architect and I work with Professor Gabriele Mastri in Ascoli. I looked at your project and I've seen that you are very much focused on public spaces and you show great sensitivity in the construction of these places. However, my remarks on places, areas where people live most of the times refers to the fact that it is there that we have a real political struggle, a real political conflict vis-a-vis, for example, the experiencing of a plaza. So my question is, are there any remarks concerning the areas in which people live in the 21st century, which are sophisticated as the ones which concern public spaces?
From 2001 until 2008, I spent all the money our company had to develop a house called Dandelion. It could break through any asphalt and pop up anywhere. It was a prefab house. We recirculated. It was a house that was to be produced. It was a house that was to be produced on recirculating and reuse with elements that could be produced. Closer?
Yeah.
Now? Okay. Better? I believe that in the housing industry, we're spending too much money on things we don't need. At the same time, we're spending too little money on things we need. So exactly what you're saying is the result of a failed housing policy.
Yeah.
And that means, in the long term, we have to find different methods of production in relationship to housing systems and housing in the future. Now, if you look at the urbanization of, say, China, what options do you have rather than building high-rise buildings with thousands and thousands of apartments exactly the same? Because it's the only way that you can move from here to here. But is that a long-term sustainable solution? No. Not even for the fastest growing cities of this world. So what do we do? I don't know. I have to be honest. I don't know. It is a huge, huge challenge, and maybe one of the biggest challenges is to find typologies in architecture that will create better housing worldwide. It's probably the biggest architectural challenge.
Good, very good question.
Buonasera.
Good afternoon.
Sono Volatili, sono un libero professionista maciratese. Quindi faccio gli onori di casa.
So I am a professional here from the area. I was really impressed by the rapid prototypation idea. I think this is something which will bring us to implementing things. What is the limit of this new applied technology? And a second question. So we have a strategy in our studio. Do you have specific strategies for small cities?
Okay, to number one, the limits of rapid prototyping elements, large-scale printing, whatever you have, is that it doesn't develop its own intelligence. That's the limit. It is control. It is a tool. It should never ever become more than a tool. Then we would probably fail. We don't have strategies for small cities. Apart,
smart cities.
Oh no, that's different. Yes, well, that's a long lecture. But yes, you can say that smart grid systems, for instance, now an introduction in Paris with the reinvent Paris system. Is one of the things that has been given has not been paid enough attention, because the overlap of the different systems has not yet been integrated. So what you're looking at is, for instance, on energy production and transport, there are too few elements that are overlapping in the way that you actually plan for larger regions. The other one is the transport system. And the third one, obviously, is how the building industry is going to react and how it's commercially going to be viable in the future. It will not be enough to have a BREEAM or a LEED certification for the building for it to increase in value in the future. Yes, it's a good starting point, but that will not be the end of this package. So what will happen when you have a good smart city is that these things work together in a larger context. That is how smart cities are now happening. We've just looked at a large-scale project in Paris, where, for instance, the amount of buildings that you sort of allocate to one type of system is reduced by overlapping and control of different other systems. It means if one doesn't deliver, the other one jumps in. You know what I'm saying? There's a full exchange of different systems that go in to feed the smart city.
Sì, no, una considerazione. Abbiamo visto
a consideration. We saw an architecture which is very different from the ones we're used to. And this is the great creativity and sensitivity of single architects who somehow need to be innovative in order to have the right appeal for the clients. So talking to young people, well, I think this, you don't have to be afraid to be yourself and to bring with you your own culture and your own idea and work hard, and you need to cooperate, you need to work in teams, choosing the right partners, because creativity and responsibility and courage are the basic elements. Of course, you need to be lucky to, but you need to be a winning person to have success, so you need to think big. So when you develop structures like the one we just saw, they of course are exceptional, extraordinary from many points of view, well, it's very difficult to do so, but these are new architectures which are kind of freer if they have, even though they have to take into consideration their settings. Well, in Europe, in Italy, we have great problems in larger cities. We have the problem to restoring buildings and to recreate kind of cities. We have large cities like Milan or Rome or Turin. We have cities which are really not meeting the requirements of today's societies. Whereas in France, there is an idea that all the dormitories, public dormitories, are owned by the public administration. There is an architect, among others, who is called Castro. He is specialized in recovering these urban spaces which are no more meeting our needs. So they maintain the structure, they change volumes here and there, and they create a new neighborhoods which can be lived. I recently went to Colombia, and actually there I had the pleasure to see Bogota once again, having a new layout, urban layout, which is now extraordinary, one of the best I ever saw lately. A sociologist who was mayor of this town, of this city, changed everything with open air, underground, and then this way you can put into connection spaces by creating a new spaces with structures which can be easily managed. So, do you have you ever worked in this field? That is to say, did you ever face this challenge of reorganizing a city? We need to create a debate on the way we can fix problems like these based on social problems. So we want to put lights on these problems. So I think young people should commit themselves and cooperate and propose a new concept, not just designs, in order to create new spaces or recover old spaces, because it is by through debate that we can develop a policy and we can change the political ideas. You, as everybody else, are connected to choices, but everyone, well, architects are those who have always changed the lifestyle in the world. You are the main point of changement. You are the booster of changes. So we need to understand, we can understand the world in a new way thanks to you, so you need to work hard to help us towards this direction.
Thank you. Yeah. One of the biggest trends for the moment is, of course, rehab. We go to this task from one point of view, and that is everything that is constructed contains energy. That means that if you subtract or have to rebuild what is already built, you have to double up the energy. First you have to take it down and you have to build as a minimum the same up again. Then you have wasted energy. So that's what is called embodied energy in reconstruction. But when you talk about big social developments, and I haven't shown all projects here obviously, but we've just made a master plan for Luanda in Angola. Now the condition for the master plan in Angola was that none of the people living there today in trying to evolve the master plan should move more than 30 meters.
Wow.
Can you imagine that as a parameter for developing a city? Now, the reason is also that these people living there, again, are so depending on street-level representation. Their small handicrafts, their small sales boutiques, they cannot survive in the sixth floor, because they will not sell anything. So how do you move only 30 meters and still maintain contact with the ground? by building and doubling the ground. So then you can double the amount of floors from 2 to 4, right? So these two floors have ground level here, and the other two floors have ground level here. And you double the floor connection level. And then you move it sequence by sequence. So all these people living now in one floor move 30 meters from this side and 30 meters from that side into the four new floors, releasing the site for the next development, which then is 30 plus 30 again. And then you have fairly spacious gardens in between. So I think, you know, they in Rwanda even, they have what they call the slow driving market. It's a traffic jam. It's a continuous traffic jam. And the cars go like 0.2 kilometers an hour. And they sell things out of the window. And the buyers walk beside them along as they're driving in this enormous traffic jam. So that also needs to be dispersed. But you cannot take away the sales again. So how do you deal with exactly these negative things? On one hand, that has created a life for so many without taking away their basic income. This is one of really also...
Formal versus informal.
Yeah. So what you do then is you create, of course, still a road system, but then maybe they just drive in circles and away from the jam, you know, or maybe you let the people come to them in a different manner. So that's how we've been trying to deal with it in Luanda.
Thank you. I'm Mark Halper from Lighting Magazine. Apologies if this question already came up, but as we're here at the Light On conference, I just wanted to ask, how important is lighting to you as you approach any project?
I've had this question before, and I'll answer it again. It happens before we start any type of design. Because usually during the winter, first thing I have to do to be able to work is to switch on the light. So in any case, light is a condition that is always at hand when designing things, together with light designers, together with people that are involved in light, together with scientists, together with people that are actually working with light in space. So yes, a lot of our concepts are based on the interaction between daylight and, again, and lack of a better word, artificial lighting. Yeah. From the very beginning. Always.
Can I get a follow-up to that? So one of your projects is Times Square. Times Square is famous for lights at night. How does that affect your design and your approach to bringing us a new Times Square?
Well, the lighting on Times Square is protected. It's part of the cultural heritage.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's part of the cultural heritage of New York already. So there are really no changes you can do to that light perception that you have on Times Square.
Right. Okay.
But the light effect then needs to be dampened. So we would never have created a completely white floor, for instance, in New York at that particular point, because the effect of the reflexes of that type of lighting would have been too strong from below. So you will see strongly in the design reflection that we've gone for a much darker floor, and darker furniture, which reflect these enormous elements less. Now, normally you would use white in order to read the color of light. In this particular case, we've reduced the effect of the readability of the light colors by a darker floor.
And it comes from the building, so it would be allowed even in Norwegian, in Norway.
I think we can thank Kjetil, we can thank iGuzzini, we can thank everybody. Please stay there. We would like to take a picture together with Kjetil. Well, first of all, we take a picture with everyone because it is a souvenir for us.
Go with Adolfo.
Thank you to you.
Thank you.
Ora no, è il ricordo per voi tutti comunque. Ci permettiamo di lasciare
a small present for all of you.
Prego.
pizza.
Su, qui vieni.
Ah, la pizza.
Cammina, Massimo, vieni. Allora, questo è il pizza cobra.
This is pizza cobra. We've talked about it. This is a product designed by Ron Arad. And in, there is a dedication for you. We normally write that that's a product for Kjetil in light design and technology that testifies to the great esteem for him and for the great collaborations that we have in the field of architecture, because it is the architect that gives dignity to architecture. This is basically the translation of what was written in English, and this is something that we would like to give to all our guests.
Wow, I feel like winning a prize.
Thank you to you.
I know, it's fantastic.
The snake.
Okay. È bloccato dal...
Va bene.
Thank you to you. Thank you to you for your coming.
Forget it, we will not be so formal and generous.
Un piccolo
Now I'm going to undress. There's going to be a small show. We normally tend to defend our social corporate colors. And so, we would like to offer you a T-shirt.
Mr. wore a T-shirt from the Maceratese here, 10 miles from here.
Non vogliamo arruolarlo, ma dare.
We do not want to hire you, actually, but this is just, again, a small present to testify our esteem for you and to have you remind you of our company.
Ayura, I'm sure you're on my side. Ma non fa niente.
È un po', sì. È un Pippo, questo è per te, Pippo, questo è per te. No, il colore rosso, il colore.
The red color is the red of our company, as you know. That's the color of Ferrari, Ducati. So that's the color of all the winning companies and products all over the world. So world means success, and that is why we continue using and wearing red.
Bene. Thank you to you, Pippo.
So we really hope that together with the MAXXI project, we will continue affirm the Made in Italy in the world. Thank you again and hope to see you soon. Hope to see you tomorrow in Rome, for those of you who will come to Rome. And thanks, and see you soon for all the others. Thank you.